What's goody with y'all today? My name is RageyVT, and today I want to talk about learning. So recently, I had the great opportunity to attend YCS Sydney, Australia. It was my second ever YCS, with my first also being YCS Sydney of 2023. And ever since that event in 2023, I've been trying to make more of a conscious effort to play the game to a more competitive level. Historically, I've always leaned more towards the casual side of the game, but getting the chance to go to a few of these events, like YCS's, locals, and other smaller tournaments over the years, I've really been interested and have leaned more into the competitive side of things. I find it a lot of fun, surprisingly. I've even shared the journey along the way here. Despite most of my content on this channel being very much more chill and casual, there's a lot that I don't get to talk about or get the chance to share when it comes to the side of the game. I mentioned it in a previous video of mine where I was talking about my love for Sword Soul now. I've been making an active effort to really improve at this game, and along the way, I've learned some really key things that I think are definitely needed in order to improve. Not even just in this game, but in any other game that you pick up. Be it another card game, or a video game, or literally anything that has a competitive scene. Some of these feel kind of like hard truths that I had to learn, but they're also just lessons that you can apply anywhere. So here are my top 4 things that I've learned so far, and things that have helped me improve better as a player. My goal isn't necessarily to be the best player of all time or anything like that, but to just be a much, much better player than I was last year or the previous year. There's something about your mindset and mentality that has to shift whenever you're trying to advance in anything. So I'm going to be doing my best to share just a few things that I've picked up along the way on my journey. Let's begin. So lesson number 1 is a bit of an obvious one, but I feel like it's worth mentioning anyway, and that's know your deck. The deck that you choose to play in any card game is essentially your weapon of choice. You need to know how to use it as best as you can. I went into my most recent competition with Sword Soul, and that's a deck that I've only been playing for a few months now, but in those few months, I've spent a lot of time just trying to learn everything about it that I can. I've even made a whole video detailing my journey with that deck thus far. Long story short, I built and learned the deck to sort of step outside of my comfort zone, because the only deck that I knew how to play inside and out, down to the T, was Code Talkers. And there's just not a lot of space for that deck to really go off with how much stronger some of the other decks in the game have been getting. Anyways, as I've been using Sword Soul, I've been getting more comfortable with the deck and how it's geared, and while I don't think I've mastered it just yet, I think the practice definitely has helped. One small thing I'll also add to this point is, above learning your deck, really know the game. As in the rules, what you can and can't do, and how everything works, because it's on top of this and the fundamentals that all decks are built. This lesson is the reason why I was able to go as far as I did with Code Talkers. It's all about knowing the actual game itself. Some decks can go outside the boundaries a little bit, but know the game, know the fundamentals, really know how to play the game. Okay, so following off with point number 2 is know the matchup and know the current landscape of the game. What are the current heavy hitters of the format? How do I play against them and around them? How does my deck of choice perform when stacked against various other decks and the current top decks? These are all important questions to ask, and the reason that I bring this point up is because, I'll admit, a lot of the time in the past, I wouldn't care what the other decks are doing. I wouldn't take the time to sit down and learn the matchups, or to even figure out what other decks actually do. Why is this deck the best deck in the game? I don't care. And it was that sort of thinking that lost me so many games. I would only focus on learning my deck and what I can do, when I didn't even put the time in to learn what other decks did unless they interested me. And when the time would come, most of the time, I was getting folded by my opponent. This was some years ago, yes, but the lesson learned has been a very important one. If you want to be able to win and do good, it's more than just knowing what you can do, but also what your opponents can do as well. This time around, I really took the time to learn what some of the current decks are doing. I know what Snake Eyes Fire King does, and what pure Snake Eyes do as well. I have an understanding of what Voiceless Voice does, even though I haven't faced anyone using the deck in person just yet. Learn the matchups. No, you're not expected to know what every single deck in the game can do, but be willing to learn a variety of different decks to figure out their styles so that you don't fall for the junk again. Very quick and funny story time. Last year, I attended my first ever YCS with YCS Sydney, Australia, and the weeks leading up, I was playing heaps of Master Duel. At one point, I ran into someone playing Rika's, a deck that I knew absolutely nothing about at the time. I had what I needed to beat them, but didn't know it at the time. I got so frustrated that I just ended up quitting the game because who cares about this deck, right? I didn't want to learn, I didn't want to know what they did, and I especially didn't want to play against them again. Fast forward to day one of the YCS event and the 7th round, as if it was a lesson returning, I went up against someone playing Rikas. I had no idea what the deck did because I hadn't learned still. Safe to say, I lost that round, but ever since then, I've learned my lesson. Do your homework. Okay, and lesson number 3 is learn to lose. This is something that I learned quickly. I want to say though that it's more learning how to lose than anything. What do I mean by this? Well, to go back to what I said at the beginning, there's something about your mindset that has to really shift when you're trying to advance in anything. Losing is a big part of anything, but I always say that there's a right way and a wrong way to do everything in life. When you lose, learn from it, keep it cool, and keep it pushing. And hey, losing happens to every one of us at some point, and it's okay to vent a bit and express your frustration. But don't be taking that junk out on someone else. Don't go after your opponent, and especially don't do the opposite of taking on this self-defeated mindset. This mindset of, oh, I knew I couldn't win that anyway. Time to get knocked out again because I'm probably gonna lose. I may as well drop after this one. Don't do that junk. Not only does it put the other person in a bit of an awkward position, but it makes you look like you just really don't care, even if you actually might. Have a winning mindset, yes, but also be prepared for when you do lose. I witnessed this firsthand in one of the rounds. I just got finished with my round 3 and I decided to walk to a random table and just spectate a bit. Maybe I could learn a thing or two from watching others duel, I thought. I was watching a Salamangreat versus Snake Eyes matchup and the Salamangreat player got clapped up. When the match was over, the opponent said GG's and the Salamangreat player proceeded to go on this wild monologue of how they could have done better and they knew the match was a loss from the start and then proceeded to give a list of reasons as to why they lost. They got out-resourced, their plays kept getting interrupted, they couldn't do much after being stopped, everything that you could think of in the book of excuses. And it was all said in this manner of it just being an absolute drag for them. Props to the opponent though. They tried to give them some helpful tips at first for what to do next time, but after the 3rd excuse or so, they kept silent and just packed up their stuff quietly and respectfully before reaching out for another handshake. Know how to lose, but also be willing to learn. Remaining teachable is one of the biggest lessons that have been taught in life, and the moment that we close ourselves off to that, things will look sour to us so much more. And finally, with lesson number 4, be willing to pivot. This one requires a little bit of a backstory that most of you would be familiar with, but to start off, the game of Yu-Gi-Oh! And heck, literally any other card game or just competitive game period is always changing. Sometimes what works last year or last month or heck, even last week, as can be the case sometimes, won't work in the current landscape. Strategies are always changing and shifting, so it's important to shift with the game. In the context of Yu-Gi-Oh! Or any other card game, sometimes this can mean changing up your deck a little or even just straight up changing the whole deck that you play. Playing the best deck in the format doesn't make you unoriginal or a meta sheep. It just is what it is. If you want to win, sometimes you have to be willing to make the necessary changes and shifts. I've talked a lot about how Kotalkers have been my go-to deck since coming back to the game in 2020. Part of the reason why that is because for a long time, I wasn't willing to play anything else but Kotalkers. It was my deck of choice for everything, for better or worse. And this really hurt me at times because my unwillingness to move would be the reason why I would feel like I'm staying still while everyone is moving ahead of me. Yeah, I was getting better at my knowledge of my deck, but I wasn't willing to leave that deck because, well, it's all I knew, and picking up something else would be too much of a time and sometimes money investment. This all sounds very dramatic, I know, but it makes sense within the context of what I'm talking about, and I'm sure that there's some people that can relate for sure. But I can say that I've learned from this properly now. I mean, the fact that I've picked up Sword Soul is proof enough that I've moved forward. But beyond just that, there's some other decks that I've been learning and building as well. Not just to be more well-rounded, but to have at least a bit of variety in my life. Be willing to pivot and also keep up with the current trends in the game and observe what's happening currently and be in the now. I'll admit that this game and some other games can be hard to keep up with sometimes, but it's worth it to keep yourself ready for how things might shift. And that does it for my lessons learned. These are lessons that I've learned over time in my efforts to become a better player. Some of these I learned fairly quickly, and some of them took some time to sink in properly. Now, there's so many more other tips that I could share that I want to, but I don't want to make this a longer video than it needs to be. One little thing that I wanted to speak on though, and this is a little bit of a unique problem that only a select group of players might experience, and it's to do with actually learning the game, and that's to learn how to play the actual physical game. Well, duh, obviously, but hear me out. There is a huge adjustment that needs to be made when transitioning from digital to physical, and you notice it pretty quickly. I've mentioned before that I play a lot of Master Duel just for myself and for this channel, but I'm definitely more of an online warrior if I'm being honest. I will pour hours into things like Master Duel, Omega, and heck, even Duel Links sometimes. Yes, I unfortunately started playing that game again. I think I'm in a very dark place. And I will use these games to learn the actual game better. And while it does help, there's just something different about playing in person. For starters, you're not told what you can and can't do, and things aren't automatically kept track of for you. You need to remember things yourself, and you have to declare things yourself too. This all sounds so obvious, I know, but if you're anything like me, this was such a struggle at first. I made an entire video going into the pros and cons of physical versus digital TCGs, and I go a lot more into this problem over there. I encourage you guys to check that video out too, because there's so much to discuss on this topic, and I'm really proud of that video too. But that aside, learning the game properly means learning how to play the game in person too. If you're an online warrior like me, looking to step out and go to some in-person events, definitely study up and also learn the etiquette of the game too. It's a very different feel when we're detached from our seats in our homes and are sitting across and around other people IRL. But coming off of all of that and getting to my actual experience this time around, it was pretty good. I only won 3 rounds this time around compared to last year when I won 4. I want to say it's because I was still getting used to my deck, but I did have enough time to practice. Hey guys, it's editor Reiji here, and I originally planned for this video to be much longer because I was going into my individual experience at the event, but then I realized while editing this video that I kind of just ramble on and geek out about all the cool things that I got and saw, and the video was shaping up to be like 30 minutes plus. So I wanted to jump in here and try to condense all of that into just a few more minutes, just so this video really doesn't turn into a movie. So going into the weekend of the event, my deck was still partially incomplete because I only had 1 Ecclesia when I need to be playing 3. I really tried to get some during day 0 of pre-registration before the main event the next day, but I had no luck and I was extremely desperate. Still though, we made it work. I had a good time just buying some stuff because I gave myself permission to just splurge a little. I mean, it's rare that I get to go to these types of events, so I used the weekend to pick up some really cool stuff. I got a bunch of shiny cards to bling out my binder, with my favorite being an ulti rare Firewall Dragon and a QCR Firewall Dragon Singularity. I love Firewall, top 10 favorite monsters of all time. I got a bunch of other QCRs because people just really don't like them, I guess. My best pickup of the weekend though was this ghost rare Clearwing Synchro Dragon, which I got for real cheap. This is also a favorite monster of mine because it belongs to one of my favorite Yu-Gi-Oh characters of all time, Yugo. Fun fact as well, I actually drew inspiration from Yugo when designing my VTuber character and everything. I also got a bunch of new playmats to also add to my collection. I don't know if I've talked about it much, but I love Yu-Gi-Oh! And TCG playmats, especially the official ones with the logos on them and stuff. They're so cool. I got a ton for cheap, but my absolute favorite ones were this Dawn of Majesty sneak peek playmat, this Phantom Nightmare sneak peek playmat, as well as this World Championship 2019 playmat. I really enjoyed my time during that weekend, but if there's anything that I would change, it's that I could go with someone like a friend or a group of friends. These types of events are definitely best when you go with others, and almost everyone that I encountered was with someone else or in a group. They're so fun with other people, and I really hope that I get to experience that one day. I don't have any friends that like Yu-Gi-Oh! IRL, but I hope I can make some good connections when I go to these events again. Over the weekend of the event, my mental game was really weak, I'll admit. Part of this was because I heard the news that Akira Toriyama, the creator of amazing works such as Dragon Ball and Dr. Slump, had sadly passed away. He was also the character designer for some of the biggest and most influential games such as Dragon Quest and the legendary Chrono Trigger. I was standing in line waiting to register for one of the side events on day zero when I was sent the notification from a friend, and after that, everything just kind of went mute for me. I left the line which I had been standing in for ages and was almost at the front, and I just proceeded to walk around the venue by myself before sitting down in silence for a bit. It was a real heavy hit for the whole world, but his work and the legacy that he has left will never be forgotten. This man inspired and shifted the culture of so much manga and media in the most unreal way, and he inspired me so much in my own work in art since I was just a kid. His work inspired me to pursue my dream and passion in game art and animation, and the influence that he had over my own life is something that I'll always be grateful for. And even in the TCG space too. The Dragon Ball Super card game is a game that I don't really play like that anymore, but I still buy the cards to this day because it's my absolute favorite card game to just collect. I've expressed it on here before that the artwork for this game is extremely well done, and this all comes from Toriyama's creation. It's absolutely amazing, and I'm just getting back into playing the game now that the digital version is available with Fusion World. Again, the influence that he had over my own life and a lot of people's lives is something that I'll always be grateful for. Rest in peace, Akira Toriyama. Well, that was my YCS Sydney experience of 2024. I'll be honest, this time around, it didn't quite hit the same as last year's one, but again, my headspace was a little everywhere going into the event this time around. I still had a ton of fun, especially when I was dueling, but also when I was able to just walk around, meet new people, and visit the different vendors to help bling out my binders. Going to a YCS is an incredible experience, and though this YCS wasn't the best one, mainly due to the extreme lack of coverage that it had again, and the venue just not being big enough to hold everyone, I still had some good fun, got some cool stuff, and learned a whole lot. I've even gotten into Edison format a bit, finally. The love for Edison at these events is actually insane, so I thought I might hop in and finally try it out for myself. One other thing that I decided to pick up as well was speed duels. Yay! Real talk though, I tried speed duels properly and I actually enjoyed it a lot. It's extremely simplified for new and returning players, and it's a nice change of pace if you're trying to just play some simple games. I really do like speed duels. It's also the reason why I have started playing Duel Links again. In fact, I even have some speed duel deck profile videos coming soon featuring a really fun deck and archetype that I've just been having an absolute blast with. But that will all be coming soon, so stay tuned. Thank you for following me on this journey this far, guys. I really owe it to my community on here for helping me prepare properly and just giving me some good advice. I really appreciate it a lot. But anyways, guys, that's gonna do it for me this time. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I'll see you guys again soon in the Duel Arena.